Everybody, I am Deion Brown, and you are watching and or listening to Man vs. Brand. Now, we're going to have a conversation that I think most of us have had over the course of at least the past 5 years, if not the past few decades. And that one is steeped in identity, right? And what develops our identity? How do we identify? What changes when we make realizations around our identity? Now, identity can be a stand-in for anything. It can be a stand-in for race, it can be a stand-in for gender, it can be a stand-in for a myriad of topics in which you say, hey, at this moment, this is what I now know. Now, I believe that that we exist in a time where more information and more community has been built around similarities in a way that I think for the broader part of the country, if not the world, the belief is that every form of identity is accepted, is valued, is uplifted. And for that reason, we find that diversity, equity, and inclusion is such a powerful tool because there are assumptions in the way of the world that particularly privileged and the unprivileged assume, right? And they assume that the world functions in one way. There's evidence to prove that the world may function in a different way. And it's our jobs to reconcile our own thoughts, our thought patterns, our behaviors, our habits, our preconceived notions that allow for one to not be celebrated in their identity, race, gender, ability, sexuality, a myriad of things in which I say, this is who I am and this is who I would like to be addressed and perceived in the world as. Now, we're going to talk to Michael Fosberg. Michael has an interesting story. I think to maybe some of the younger generations, it may not seem as sort of, wow, I can't believe that happened as it does now, because the proliferation of social media has made a wide range of skin tones, mixed ethnicities sort of more prevalent in a way that there is some level of visibility in those communities. But Michael's story is one in which he grew up in middle-class Chicago with a white mother who eventually revealed to him that his birth father was in fact black, which then made Michael biracial and then created in him a journey, right? Part of that journey was to create Incognito as a book. Then it moved on and transformed into a one-act play or one-person play. Not one-act play, one-person play. Take that back. Or maybe a one-person play that is also a one-act play. That'd be actually kind of interesting. No intermissions, no breaks for you guys. Then he began to use the material and the content to support diversity and inclusion in corporations, for individuals, for teams, et cetera. Now, I think that there is a lot to sort of unpackage in the story. In part, you know, the history of Michael discovering this new aspect to his identity. But more so, what's compelling about the story to other people, right? That's I think a part of this, right? Is it a passability factor? Is it a I made a first assumption, now I'm making a second assumption, or is it quite literally a white appearing person telling a story that involves blackness in it, that could be more well received than if it was in fact told by a person who looked more black. Who knows, right? That's the whole point of a podcast, is to dissect and to engage in dialogue that allows for us to investigate why we make the assumptions that we do, why we elect to live in the identities and truths that we live in, and why we create different forms of medium to support new ideas, to support divergences in our journeys, to support our overall lives. So Michael, welcome to Man vs. Brand. How you doing?
Good, Dion. Thanks for having me. It's good to speak with you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So talk to me, man. Tell me a little bit about the history. I sort of did a broad overview of it, but what was your experience? What was your lived experience like?
Yeah. So essentially I was raised in a working class white family by my biological mother, who was of Armenian descent, and an adoptive stepfather who was of Swedish descent. When I was in my early 30s, they announced that they were getting a divorce. And I realized at that time that I didn't know anything about my biological father. My mother had never told me anything, and I'd never asked questions. It kind of threw me for a loop. I was really, I was in my early 30s at the time, and you'd think, well, you're an adult, you know, your parents are getting a divorce. Happens. Lots of people go through divorces, you know, but yeah. I guess perhaps maybe because I didn't know my biological father, or I blame my mother for the divorce. I was really angry with her. I don't know, a lot of stuff going on at the time. And at the time I had a British girlfriend who, suggested that, the anger was misplaced, and maybe the anger had something to do with the fact that I didn't know who my biological father was and that I needed to ask my mother some questions. And so I asked my mom some questions about my upbringing, about my biological father, and she gave me two bits of information. She told me his name, which was John Sidney Woods, and she told me that the last time she'd spoken with him, which was some 30 years ago, he lived in the Detroit area, she thought. And so armed with those two bits of information, I went to the library, which this is going to date all of us. Libraries used to have phone book sections. Phone books, remember those?
Yeah, they're big.
Yeah, right. And so they had a lot of libraries would have phone books from major cities around the country. I was living in Santa Monica, California at the time. I went to the library. I found the Detroit phone book. I looked up his name. There were about five or six listings. I went home. I was scared out of my mind. I didn't know what to do. And so I finally got the courage. I picked up the phone. I dialed the first number on the list.
Yep.
And a guy answers the phone. And I was like, oh boy, now what do I do? I got to step up now. And so I said, I'm looking for a John Sidney Woods. And he said, you're speaking with him. And I was like, oh, okay, it can't be that easy, right? There's got to be more than one John Sidney Woods or whatever. So I said, did you live in the Boston area in 1957? Because that's where we lived. We lived in the Roxbury district of Boston in 1957.
Shout out to Roxbury. Love that place.
There you go.
Yeah.
And I was like, waiting and waiting. And he kind of said, yes, I did. And I thought, oh, no, this is too easy. I said, were you married to an Armenian woman by the name of Adrian Piliposian? That was my mother's maiden name. And he paused what seemed like an eternity. And he said, yes, I was. And I realized I had tracked my father down on a first phone call after 30 years. And so we're on the phone and we're trying to wrap our heads around, you're my dad, I'm your son. How do we talk about this? What do we say? What do we talk about? You know, it's 30 years gone by. What do you say to a guy? And then out of the blue, he says to me, you know, son, there's a couple of things you should know. I'm sure your mother never told you. And I'm thinking, okay, aside from not telling me about you, I mean, what else could there be? And he says, well, first of all, I want you to know that no matter what you were told or what you thought happened, I've always loved you and I've thought about you a lot. And I was so deeply touched by that, just really touched. And then he said, there's one other thing I'm sure your mother's never told you. And I said, what? And he said, I'm African American.
Wait, so pause on this story. So
yeah,
a few things before I think you continue to the next part. So I think that there are some clarifications that I, hearing this story, would love to get from you, and I imagine the audience would like the same. So up until this point, you knew that your mother's husband that she divorced was not in fact your biological father. So it wasn't as if you believed this other person who was Swedish, I believe, to be your father. You always knew that this person wasn't, that there was another man that existed in the world that was in fact your dad.
That's correct.
Okay, so it wasn't like a double reveal. It wasn't like this isn't your dad. This has never been your dad and we're getting a divorce. It was, I'm getting a divorce from your stepfather.
That's correct. Although she didn't use the word stepfather. Okay. I think it's helpful to suggest or to let you know that. So my mother and I left my biological father when I was 2 years old.
Okay.
And she remarried when I was almost 5 years old.
Okay.
And then when I was about 8, she had a child. They had a child. And then when I was 9, they had another child. So I grew up. It's hard to think about like what a 2 year old, what a 3 year old, what a 4 year old is processing. You know what I mean?
Of course.
I knew there wasn't a father there, but I wasn't actually really, I guess, maybe cognizant of what that meant. We grew up in when we left my biological father, we moved back to Waukegan and we lived with my grandparents and my grandfather, my mom's parents. My grandfather became the male figure in my life.
Okay.
And I just adored him and he adored me.
Well, so this is my very quickly, because there's also another part to this that I want to sort of clarify before we move. And maybe this is revealed in the fact that your biological father and your mother were together until you were 2, because the reveal that he's Black would also assume that Blackness wouldn't have appeared in you, right? So he knew enough about what you looked like, right? So, because at this point, the way that the story is sort of structured is you're calling a person 30 years saying you're my dad, and they reveal that they're Black, but most people don't have to reveal that they're Black because most oftentimes in biracial, multiracial, there's some level of skin tone and melanin that would identify something other than white, right? So
yes.
Did he reveal this to you because he knew you for 2 years and knew that wasn't the way that you were shaping out to be? Or was it more so like, you know, in a list of things your mom might have not told you, let me give you more information? Like, why did that become a part, do you believe, at this point, now reflecting on it, you know, so much time later, that part was such a pertinent piece of information, specifically after affirming that he's loved you and thought about you all this time?
Yeah, so he, you know, raised me for the first 2 years of my life, so he knew what I looked like.
Okay.
And then the circumstances of their failing relationship and then our parting, our my mother taking me and leaving, also suggested to him that he knew that I hadn't been told.
Got it.
And those things were ranged from when they were together and desperately trying to make ends meet and trying to figure out what to do, one of the options that they had explored was to move back with his parents. But they lived in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and this was 1957, and this was before Loving versus the State of Virginia, so it would have been illegal for them to live in the state. So that wasn't an option. The other option was for them to move back home with her parents, but that wasn't going to be an option unless my father agreed to pass, which he did not and would not do. And so he knew that
a racial concept of saying that he would then also say that he was not Black or not African American.
That's correct. He was very light skinned, but that wasn't on the plate. That wasn't an option for him. And so that combined with when my mother finally did leave, she wrote him a letter of which my father kept and gave to me when I reconnected with him 30 years later. And in that letter, my mother basically lays out to him that she couldn't raise me to be Black. She didn't know how to do it. And so all of those factors made it clear that why my father said, I'm African American.
So you are dialing him, right? From, yeah. Are you dialing him from the library or are you at home?
No, now? No, I went home. I went home.
You're home. Okay. Just to clarify, right?
Yeah, right.
So it's not like you're like, what? In the whole library.
In the library.
Right? Keep it on. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That was like a thing. So you're home. You're an adult at this point, right? So you have in some part cemented elements of what you believe yourself to be true, right? Now, let me know as we get older, those things also may or may not evolve. But in some way, you say, I think I know who I am. This is how I show up in the world. Yeah. XYZ. Was there ever a sense, aside from the fact that your biological father wasn't in your life, that something was not being shared with you, like with your grandparents or with your mom? Like, was there a sense of like, there's this kind of gap that I, as a child, because you were just mentioning about being a 2 and 4 year old and not cognizant, but at some point you become aware that maybe this topic is not a topic that anyone around you wants to discuss, right? Like, yeah. One point where you just go, I'm just going to be blissfully unaware and accept this version of my life and let whatever the other version of my life kind of be separate and different. So did you ever feel a gap or, you know, ever kind of wonder and feel like you weren't getting answers that really sort of fulfilled that need to know more about your biological father?
Yeah, well, I will say that once I started to get older, 5 and 6 and 7, and then a child, 8 and 9, a brother, then a sister, I started to accept more that I had this family that I saw as, I mean, I probably didn't describe it this way, as my nuclear family, though. You know, like I started to feel like I had a brother, I had a sister, I had a dad. This is all, oh, okay, I see how this works. And prior to that, and actually during that, I was a really scared kid. I was scared of everything. I didn't learn how to swim because I was afraid of the water. I was just scared about all kinds of stuff. And so asking questions was not an option in my family necessarily. Well, not an option because my family doesn't ask questions, but also not an option for me because I was a really scared kid and I didn't know how to like step forward and go, hey, who's my dad? Oh, wait, I'm sorry, dad. I meant my other dad. You know what I mean? That just wasn't a part of my my makeup. And so as it went along, you know, more and more, I started to feel more and more comfortable with the family and with, you know, my place in the family and all of that. And so, and I don't, like my grandparents, nobody in my family talked about it all, ever, ever. I don't ever remember anybody saying anything about my biological father or even having another father.
Yeah.
I mean, that was never, and part of that was because my mom's parents were Armenian immigrants and they were, you know, they were very much against the marriage. They were very much against it. They disowned her when they found out that she was pregnant by a Black man. They didn't talk to her for 2 years. And then when Howie ended up going back to my grandparents' house and leaving my father was that my grandmother came out and secretly visited us while my father was away at work, saw that I had white skin, saw that we were living in the projects and had no money, and begged my mother to come back home with her. And my mother being scared all of that period of time, like no food, no help, no family members, agreed that she would go back, and there were problems between her and my father, and so she agreed to go back, and she left my father, and then again there was no conversation about it after that.
So all right, so we're gonna get into the play itself, because I want to actually you know, sort of work through that process. But I think that there is actually something interesting that I'm hearing in what you're saying, which is it sounded like your mom dealt with a lot of fear. Oh, and the byproduct, her child also existed in a space that included fear, right? And so I could see how if I watched my parent always concerned, to never want to add any level of more concern to their concern, right? So I'll be more risk averse. I'd be less likely to ask questions, right? Because I'm watching the person who I love, specifically from a child's perspective, fight through, stress through. And even if you don't know the intricacies, even if it's not rent or food or whatever, emotionally, we understand visual, tone, physical cues. Right.
And absolutely.
And so I can see a space where that's how you would be. That's how you would show up in the world and then find solace in a family unit where now there is a wider range of emotion aside from fear and concern, and that you might find some solidarity in that.
Absolutely. You know, experts say that the first 2 years of your life are the most formative years. And that's where you get a lot of who you are, of your personality. And so I was, as you so aptly pointed out, I was being raised by a mother who was in fear every day about, how am I going to feed this kid? I've got no friends to talk to. I've got no family to talk to. And so I was absorbing that. And I just, you know, took that along my ride. That became a part of my journey as well. So that, yeah, you nailed that. Yeah.
Absolutely. So, all right. So you hear the news and that's your first call. What's your second?
The second phone call that I got?
Yeah. Like, no, the second phone call that you made. That's your first phone call, right? So you have that conversation.
Yeah.
You reveal. Well, what there's next.
Yeah, there's two key phone calls that happened. One was to my mother, and the other one was actually from my grandmother. So the first, let's deal with the first, because we are talking about my mother. The first thing after I found out who my father was and what he was, I was livid. My mother had kept this information from me my entire life. And so I was so angry with her. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how to talk to her. I didn't know how to confront her. I had to confront her. I had to tell her, hey, I found my dad. But how was I going to tell her? Like, you lied to me. You know, like I just was so filled with anger. And literally, I think it was minutes before I was going to pick up the phone to call her, not knowing what I was going to say or how I was going to confront her. The phone rang. I answered the phone, and it was a friend of mine by the name of Tommy, who also ironically happened to be from Detroit originally. And I told him the news about what had happened. And he said to me, the first thing he said to me was, I always knew you were Black. And I was like, what? Like, I'd heard that throughout a lot of my life. People would come up to me and say, oh, you got some Black in you. You must be Black. And I was like, I don't know where you get that. There's nothing in my family to suggest.
Now, do you think that was being said as a ridicule, as a compliment, or just purely as an observation? In all of the times, not just Tommy, but as heard it over the course of your life, like, where do you think that insight or that observation was accredited to? Because this is also still a time, and arguably we still exist in a time, right, where race was very polarizing, where, you know, things like that could cause physical harm, emotional harm, teasing, rejections from school. So, like, when those observations were made, how were you interpreting them?
Well, most of those type of observations came from Black friends.
Okay.
So they were like, you're one of us. And I would be like, I don't know what you're talking about. I love hanging out with you, but I don't know what you're talking about. You know, and so from a place of love. And I jokingly refer to that nowadays as having black dar. Like we kiddingly say people have gaydar. They can tell gay people. Well, I talk about black people have black dar. They can tell somebody who's black. Tommy was not black.
Yeah.
He was white, but he did grow up in Detroit, and he did grow up in a very integrated neighborhood. And he did, you know, honestly believe that there was something about me that was different. Other people had said this, and he was just like, it just seemed to resonate. And I was like, I don't know, man. You know, like, and he said, when he said that, it was just like sort of, I laughed, of course. And then I shared with him the anger that I had towards my mother. And he said, no, man, no, you have an opportunity to absolve your mother of her shame. She was given this shame by her Armenian parents, Armenian immigrants, and has held on to it your entire life. And you now have a chance to help her let it go, to help her release her shame and guilt. And in that, I realized, like, it opened my mind. It was the most beautiful thing I'd heard. It opened my mind to understand what my mom had gone through. It was 1957. There was literally no biracial community in America, at least no acknowledged biracial community. She was disowned by her parents. She was living in fear, abject fear every day. She was living with this. And so I realized that was such a burden, so difficult for her. And I never considered it in that way before. And it was, it gave me the permission to forgive her.
Now, I have a question, and I think that I want to framework this question. I've been thinking it through for the entirety of this early part of the conversation, because I think it also is important because visibility was different then. A lot of Armenian friends that I have, people that I know, folks that I worked with, people I went to college with, are my skin tone, if not darker, right? So is this in fact about blackness as a color, or is this like color, which is more like colorism, or is it in fact about African-American and being black and the culture and the ethnicity? Because being Armenian is so, and I don't want to take anything from the grandparents and, you know, what they may or may not look like, but in my current life, Armenians tend to be on the darker skin tone range.
What we are called in the Armenian community is olive skinned, is how Armenians are referred to as olive skinned. So
sure, but there's still some level of melanin, right? So olive, I think, is a nicer way of characterizing non-Caucasian appearing skin, but still the idea is that there's melanin. So was it a hope of color? Like was it a hope of like, I hope he doesn't end up too dark? Because I have a lot of friends that's an issue, right? Like skin tone becomes a part of their family's conversation, whether they're Hispanic, African-American, Armenian, Israeli, like just skin tone is more of an issue than actual race itself, right? It's just like, listen, we want the kids to look like us, because sometimes skin tone is tied to advantage, right? So colorism is also a part of moving through social networks and social opportunities sometimes. And so what do you think it is? Do you think it was like a thing of hoping that you weren't going to end up dark, or them really understanding what African American marriages or mixed marriages faced at that time period, or just kind of blatantly like, we just don't really want you to be with a black man, so find a nice Armenian boy and or someone else and have a good life?
Well, I will concur that their colorism is an absolutely a thing within the world. I mean, the number one cosmetic product in India is skin lightener. That's the largest selling cosmetic product in India. So there is this desire to be lighter. I would take umbrage with your description of Armenians being as dark as you.
I said I know Armenians that are dark as me.
I know none as dark as you.
Okay, I think that's great.
This is not to say that there aren't some. I'm just saying in my Armenian community that I grew up in, I don't know any who are as dark as you. That's not to say that there aren't any. And this is something we should probably talk about, is all of us, Armenian, Black, Asian, Indian, we're not a monolith.
Sure.
We're all different on many different scales, not just personality and identity, but also on color scale. And so in a black family, you can have a mother, father, son, and daughter, all different shades.
Of course.
In an Armenian family, same thing could be true, but the difference would be slightly narrower.
Sure. But I think even if there is some degree of median narrowness, right, it still just begs to differ. If there are olive skin, using your term, not mine.
It's not my term.
I'm using the term you're using in this.
It's the term that was used within my Armenian community.
Absolutely. No, I'm saying, like, when you, I said darker, you said, well, we use olive. So I'm just using, you know, I'm agreeing with your terminology and using it for the sake of the conversation, right? Olive, if you're from Spain, Italy, Greece, right? Still indicates some level of melanin, right? And so I guess that's what I'm trying to get to. Is it that maybe where they were from, it lacked that sort of melanated skin tone? Or was it something completely social and about the time? I'm just trying to determine the difference between maybe, do you believe that this is, was this about color or was this in fact about race? Because
I think it was about both.
It could not be about race and actually be about color. And it could be a combination of both, or it could be about one or the other. And
I absolutely think it was about both. I mean, I don't know that my grandparents, as far as I'm aware, my grandparents never met my father, but just probably hearing that he was Black or described as such, probably wasn't described as Black back in the 1950s. He was probably described as African-American, or actually probably Negro was the term that was used.
Yep.
And so that connotes everything, right? Especially for an immigrant. And so then to see my skin tone, as my grandmother did when she came and saw me, was a colorism issue. So she could accept me because I looked white, even though my father was a Negro.
Got it. Okay. That's interesting. I think your reference around some of my friends who are of Indian and or Pakistani culture are very much, as you said before, and African culture, a lot of African culture too, are very much about protecting skin tones and ensuring skin tones. And I think that sometimes the two are conflated as one, or like racism or nationalism, colorism, and texturism. Right, which are all very separate and different, right? So you could appear white but not have white features or hair or, you know, whatever that thing is, right? So just sort of pinpointing that thing so that there's not a broad stroke applied to maybe what the issue might be, and really kind of honing in on it, at least kind of gives context to what you were experiencing at the moment and maybe what your thoughts were and what the revelations were, in fact.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so you get a call from Tommy. Tommy's like, give mom some grace, give mom some grace, and help her out. You're now priest. You're now giving that sort of that empathy that will hopefully allow her to heal from how traumatizing all of this was, right? Because she would have had a baby with the man and married a man if she did not in fact love him. And then societal pressure caused that relationship to separate and divorce. And now she's living this life with parents who hadn't spoken to her for 2 years. So, and trying to raise a baby, right? So there's a whole lot going on. Right. So he calls, then I guess you're like, okay, now I'm ready to have this conversation with my mom.
Well, yeah. Then I called my mother, and I mean, the lesson that Tommy gave me, in addition to the word you beautifully used, grace, the lesson that he gave me was that is about forgiveness. It's the hardest work that you will ever do, but also the most rewarding. And by forgiving, being able to forgive my mother, I could open a space for us. I could let go of my resentment. As many of us maybe are aware of or not aware of, resentment, if you hold resentment, it just sits on you. It is like a poison. And so I was able to release that, let go of the resentment, forgive my mother for what she did. She did what she needed to do as best she could. And we had this beautiful conversation, this beautiful phone conversation, and the rest is history. We've been very, very close ever since then, and have had many, many conversations, open conversations about it, about the situation and about our lives and everything. So yeah, that was very healing.
Great. And then your grandmother called you, you said.
And then, so I got a little care package in the mail. Well, no, that actually, my grandmother called me first, waking me up at, I don't know, 6 a.m. or whatever, with this Southern voice, and just, you know, like, how the hell are you? Where the hell you been? And I was like, wait, who's this? And she didn't introduce herself. She just said, where the hell you been? That was the first thing she said on the phone. I was like, what? And I, as I was waking up and listening to this, I sort of pieced together, wait a minute, this voice, this person, this has got to be. And then she said, how the hell are you, sugar? And I said, granny. And of course she said, yeah, it's your granny. And she said, we've been expecting you 10 years ago. Where the hell you been? And
so you gave him your phone number after, so you guys exchanged information after your initial call. Okay, got it. All right. Cool. So great. Was caller ID happening at that point, or like
no caller ID?
This was something that you had to decide to do.
Pre-caller ID, right? According to my grandmother, actually, right after I phoned my father for the first time, he hung up the phone and immediately called his parents.
Of course.
So they knew about it right away.
Yeah.
So I had this beautiful phone call with my grandmother, and you know, we were going to stay in touch, and we exchanged information, all that kind of stuff. And then 2 weeks later, I get a little care package in the mail, and in that care package from my grandmother is an envelope of photographs, including photographs of my granny holding me as a baby and other photographs. And then there was this little tissue wrapped object in that box. And when I unwrapped that tissue, it was my baby shoe. And my grandmother had kept my baby shoes all these years. She kept one on her bedside table, and she sent the other one to me.
It's beautiful. Now, what about your mom's parents? How did that conversation work?
Yeah, so my mom's parents, this is, I guess, an irony of this, had passed away before I went on this journey.
Got it.
Yeah. Yeah. And as I went on the journey, and I discovered more and more about the fact that it was them that played a big role in the separation of me from my Black family.
Yeah. I mean, that's also, I think, tough in a way, right? On both sides, because as you said, right, like holding things, right? And things could, there's a ton of things. There's resentment, there's regret, there's jealousy, there's infidelity, there is untruthfulness, right? Holding those things for years and years become little weights, right? In this backpack of life, right? That you then start to drag around with you, right? And so I hope that, you know, they were able to unpack that. in their own ways before their passing, so that it, no, because I think that's important. My grandmother passed. I've spoke about this on the podcast. She was in hospice, had, I think it was like 5 strokes in the course of a weekend, immediately could no longer speak. They found out she had a brain tumor, gave her steroids, brain tumor decreased. She then could speak again, had her memory back. She had memory problems for about the previous 4 to 5 years. I'd seen her, we did at-home hospice. I left my business that I was running as an entrepreneur, left that business, let other people run it, went home for a few weeks to just take care of her with my aunt, my cousin, and my grandfather. In the last days right before she leaves, and I don't know how much you know about hospice, but there's different degrees. Like there's periods where they stop eating and drinking, and then there's a period where there's like this renewed energy. And she looked at me and she goes, and my mother passed violently. My dad died also when I was young, and I'm an only child. And she looked at me and she said, "I did good." You know, and it's ultimately what you want when you're at that moment, right? When you're at that moment of passing, where you as a person, you don't really, really know what's on the other side, right? You don't know the scales, right? Are the scales in fact tipped in your favor, right? Has the good that you've done really outweigh the things that you wish you would have done differently, right? And so the hope is that everyone gets that moment, right? That was a life-changing moment for me, is to realize that in the final moments, I don't want to be kicking and screaming. I don't want to be fighting for more time. I want to look back at the things that I did, good or bad, right or wrong, and say, "I did good." And if you can do that in your final hours, then God bless you for whatever that afterlife will look like. So me saying that is really sort of going through my own journey and understanding the importance of being able to remove some of the baggage at the last parts of your life in order for you to feel good about what's waiting for you on the other side.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, I don't know if my grandparents had that moment. I mean, again, we did not, I did not go on this journey and make this discovery before they passed. So I have no idea what they felt or what they thought about in terms of, you know, our history, with my biological father. And so I can only hope that they, you know, had all their ducks in order so that they felt good about going out of this world. So,
yeah, listen, like, right. Like we're not, the beautiful thing I think about adulthood is that you realize that parents are just people, right? Like they're people, right? They're making the best decisions with the information that they have. And some of those decisions serve their children, some don't, right? And so, in a way, you know, there is no real hero, no true villain, right? All of it is shifting, right? Like I could be a villain to you, but a hero in this life, or I could be a villain at this point in your life and a hero at this point in your life, right? So, you know, I think that's a beautiful thing about life, is that you get to not, when you understand it a little bit more deeply, or specifically yourself a little more deeply, you recognize that everyone has the capacity to be everything to everyone. And so you determine, like, hey, I hope that they are good and that they got that off, or you're like, screw y'all, you know, wherever you land, right? There are people that's how they look at the people that pass. So good for you for, you know, just kind of acknowledging that and hoping for that. So now you have this living family, this new unit of individuals, for you to have the ability to create connection with, your family that at this point has been made smaller by some deaths is made sort of larger, by some inclusions. Right. Did your mom and your dad, your biological dad, ever have a moment of reconciliation amongst themselves?
Yeah, I don't know how much of reconciliation it was. I mean, they did come full circle. My mom went to visit a friend of hers in Wilmington, North Carolina, and together they drove up to
is that where you're from? Wilmington, North Carolina. That's where my grandparents were from. That's where my grandmother passed. I love Wilmington. Shout out to Wilmington.
Yeah, so she went to visit her friend there, and then together they drove to Virginia Beach, and my father was there, and they had a reunion, and they welcomed her with open arms, and so it was, you know, it was full circle. I don't know how much of, you know, things forgiven or reconciled or whatever were actually took place, but it did come full circle, and that was nice to know.
Have you ever gotten a chance to go to Wilmington?
I have been, yeah, absolutely.
And Hanover Beach, like I my family moved there from New York, and so I had great memories.
Yeah.
I guess even back, I would imagine around that time is like the whole Dawson's Creek sort of Wilmington being like this idyllic place, and then now traffic is like 3 hours. It's like a whole different place. It was like at one moment it was like creeks and just like, you know, a beach like Wrightsville and all of that.
That's everywhere, man. Traffic is everywhere.
No, at one point it just was kind of like swampy lands. There was a few things that had you and
I'm just saying now.
Yeah, now it's like
everything's been discovered now.
Yeah, it's like beachfront. I'm like, what? Yeah. When was this beachfront? All right, yeah. So that's the history. You then come to this book.
Yeah.
Right? The book that leads to the one man show. So Incognito is something that either has a negative or positive connotation dependent on the user and the context, right? It's one of those terms, right? So you can either the person is intentionally hiding the identity of something, or the identity of something is hidden, yet to be revealed.
Right.
So when, and those have very different sort of connotations and ideas and intent around, right? So when you came to the word incognito, what did that word resonate for you? Because it's the title is incognito. So what were you thinking when you landed on that name and specifically that word?
Well, I think both of the definitions that you described, I think what I'm doing is, well, first of all, I was incognito because I didn't know who I was or what I was. I didn't know my story. Now I do know. But I'm actually holding it back before I tell you it in the story or in the book. And so it seemed to have both applications of that. And it just seemed to be such a appropriate word for the journey, for my, you started this off talking about identity, my journey with identity.
Okay. So you being an actor helped you to be in the, or to write or and develop this one-man show, or did you develop the one-man show, then become the actor? Had you had your hand in playwriting before? Like, how did that shift occur? Was that already something that was in your ecosystem, something you were doing professionally or recreationally? Yeah.
I'm a trained actor. I went to school. I graduated from the University of Minnesota in Minneapolis with a bachelor in fine arts, acting and directing and writing. And have been acting my whole life and writing my whole life. And so when this happened to me, what I did was I started writing it as a book. I didn't actually think about doing it as a play at first. I was like, oh, this would make a really interesting story, a really interesting book. And so I'd never actually written a book before. I'd written some plays, but I thought, okay, well, I'll give it a shot. So I started writing it. And then I was asked to read some of the chapters out loud to a group of people one night. And so that night I read, I don't know, I chose five or six stories and I read them aloud and people were laughing and they were crying and they were like, oh my God, you should be doing this. And I said, yeah, I am. I'm writing the book. And they said, no, you should be performing it. And again, you know, I'm a trained actor. I could do that, but that wasn't what I had in my mind. I was thinking, well, I was going to write a book. I don't know. And then I did another reading and I got the same response. And so that sort of dragged me into performing it. And so I actually ended up performing the play for a number of years before I actually finished the book. Because once the play started, it just took off. I mean, people just were like gaga about it. It was like, oh my gosh, this is incredible. It's amazing. And you know, the press was all over it. It was incredible. It was really great. And then I started touring and doing all this stuff. And I thought, well, this is really great. But then I started understanding the power of the play, the power of the story to open up conversations with people about race and identity.
Okay.
And so I started to have these post-show conversations. And then that became a part of every performance. I would do a post-show conversation and we would unpack the play. And I was learning all kinds of things as I was going on, as I was doing it, because I didn't actually even realize how many different topics and ideas and issues were in the play, in the story. It just, you know, it was like my personal story. I didn't think about it on that level. And then as I kept doing it, I started to see all these different things. And so I started to unpack it with audiences. And then it took me another, I don't know, 8 years or so to finish the book. So,
got it. So what was your audience diversity like, right? Specifically African-Americans tend to be underrepresented in audiences, specifically in theater or play, musical type works. Traditionally, right? I think that there has been some performances and some inclusions of works like Hamilton, Color Purple, Cats that have changed a lot of representation and cast and story, then creating interest in representation and diversity in the audience. So when you were doing your play, what was your audience like? And was there any differentiation that you could perceive specifically in these panel talks of how this conversation differed dependent on who that person was and their lived experience?
Yeah, absolutely. I have some great examples to share with you. I will say in the last couple of years, perhaps since the George Floyd murder, there has been a reckoning in theater, and theaters are filled with people of color now. I mean, audiences and on stage, it's pretty amazing what's happened. When I was doing it, however, back in 2001, 2002 is when I first put it up on stage. 2003, one of the places I went to with the show was the Kansas City Repertory Theater. And I had, the audience there was actually pretty diverse, and we did something there with the PR department where they wanted to attract Black audience members and they wanted to let them know that the play was about them. In other words, that it dealt with not just a guy going out to find his biological father, but a guy going out to find his biological father and discovering he's Black and discovering this rich Black history and going all of this. But we also didn't want to give that secret away to white audiences because we wanted the surprise for them of coming into the theater and seeing this guy going searching for his father. And then, oh wait, he's Black? Wow. So they advertised it differently to each of those communities in order to draw both in. And they were very successful with that. As a matter of fact, at one point there was a subscriber, and I think she was a board member, a Black board member who came and saw the show and was knocked out by it and invited tons of her friends to come and see it. And then she asked if she could host a party with me as the guest, as the, you know, the guest of honor. And I was like, yeah, absolutely. And so I ended up after the show going to her, all her friends came and saw it. There must've been, I don't know, 35, 45 people, Black people, yeah, came and saw the show. It was like the talented 10th. I mean, these were the who's who of the Black community in Kansas City. And I ended up going to their house after the show, and we just sat down and they all gathered around and we had this amazing conversation about race and about blackness and about all these different issues that the play unspooled. And so it was really, that was my first clue that it had resonance and obviously in both communities. And then I had the delight to be invited to the National Black Theater Festival in Winston-Salem twice. They have it every other year. And I got invited 1 year and then 2 years later, I got invited again. And most of the audiences there are black. And again, had more incredible conversations with that. So,
because to me, right, there is a myriad of conversation involved, but there are sort of in listening to this story and seeing what was available of the play online. There is sort of curiosity of the white appearing man finding out that he's black and what does he do with that? And then there's the, how do you reconcile the privilege of whiteness when you know that you are in fact not fully white, right? And so were there also conversations around privilege? Because a great movie, I don't know if you've ever seen it. I think it's 1958-9, Imitation of Life.
There's several versions of that film. There's three versions of that film. Yes, I've seen all three.
All right, cool. Yeah, so Imitation of Life. It was, well, I don't know which version. I know there's one version that like was predominant in our household. It's the one I think. What?
In the 50s, probably the one.
One in the 50s, right? Biggest one in the 50s. I think that was the one that was like predominant in our family's life. Sure. And so that conversation is about privilege, is about determining when to use that privilege and how far away from who you are as a person you can kind of go. So were there conversations that were purely about race and ethnicity, or were there also larger conversations around privilege, around society, around perception and advantage in perception back in those times? I know those conversations are prevalent now, but in the 2000s, I think there was black and white academia having these conversations. It's happening in colleges and schools, happening in the arts. I think social media became proliferated these ideas to a broad mass, to a younger mass, and made them more aware. So were those conversations a part of the conversations that you were having in panels and parties and sort of when you were discussing the play and sort of the audience's interpretation of the play?
Yeah, absolutely. There's always been a wide variety of topics. That's why I was saying, when I first did the play, I just thought I was telling my story. I didn't really think about the implications. I mean, there are just so many different things. The story is just as much about family secrets as it is about privilege, as it is about race, as it is about all these other things. Every family has a secret. I've found that out. Like, people come up to me after the show and tell me these deep, dark secrets from their families. And I'm like, oh boy, wow. I opened that door.
Well, wait, hold on. So back in 74, kidding. You know, no worries.
Exactly. I mean, it's crazy the kind of response that I get sometimes. I love opening this door, and I love that it forces people to sort of confront their own issues about race, identity, family secrets, all these different things, privilege, microaggressions, all these different things are sort of a part of this whole journey. But, you know, there are oftentimes, I'll be after a show, someone will corner me and they just, like they won't stop talking. And, you know, and you're just like cornered and you can't, and I don't want to say to them, oh, look, I'm really sorry. I can't listen to this right now. I mean, I've opened that door for them. And so you want to give them the privilege to, I just gave them the privilege to do that. And I'm going to say, no, I can't listen to your story. It's too crazy or whatever it might be. So there is an aspect of how many different people, you know, open up and feel permission to tell their story.
So when you're experiencing this, this play, these conversations, what's happening to you as a person, right? So we've been describing is maybe talking about the experiences of the audience of workshops in which this is happening, of listeners to readings, right? But what's happening to you? How had the play and then the years following to write the book, what did you discover about yourself that you hadn't discovered at the time that you finished writing the play, right? So you knew all this information, right? You started making new relationships. You start writing the book. It turns into a play. You work this play. You're doing theaters, you know, places. It's moving around. You're workshopping it. You write a book. What had you discovered by the time you wrote the book that you really didn't know about yourself when you were working it as a play? Because that's a good span of time in terms of growth and maturity as an individual.
I guess I would say the big important lesson for me in this has been that I understand that as a first of all, I'm a biracial individual. I'm not the biracial spokesperson.
Sure.
But I also realize that as a biracial individual, I have an opportunity to be a bridge to help people cross race, cross ethnicity, cross nationality, cross gender, maybe even perhaps, to have rich, authentic conversations about who we are and how we see one another. And I didn't see that when I first started the journey. That is what became apparent to me as I went along this ride.
Absolutely. I mean, now the kids call it, you built a platform, right? And so you kind of go from obscurity to being a point person for whatever that topic is, right? And it's something that, you know, is, I think the beautiful thing about art is that it if you allow it to, it organically grows, and it grows in the way that the audience consumes it, but also grows in the way that you understand the work itself, right? And the work starts to feel different, right? And and insights into the man that wrote that line may feel different. So that line may even be delivered quite differently, because it might have some punch to it, right? Or it may be not as, you may not feel that was, I mean, I don't know, right? I've learned in theater, as you watch, I've seen a multitude of shows go from like readings to like full productions, to like regional productions, and watching them and each person sort of take on it and slight deviations. And you realize that specifically in plays where the director is also the playwright, that their collaboration with the actor, which in this case would be yourself, right? You start to, as the art starts to inform you of itself, you then start to make decisions, right? And you start to grow as a actor and as a person and as a writer. And so that's really interesting to know. So you write this book. It's done, right? You have fully written this book. If the one man show is about reflecting conversations, right?
Yeah.
How does that then translate into the book? Is the book sort of formulated in the same way as the play, or is it more like structurally, like just a narrative that of your perspective of this? Is it broken down into, you know, in how these different characters would be interacting? Is there the perspective of your mom, your dad? Like, how did the play then inform the final product of what the book looked like?
Well, there are actually now two books. The Ooh. First book, which is the memoir, which is what you're referring to, is the framework of that was a journey that I took across the country, driving across the country from West Coast to East, interviewing each member of my family to write this book. And then I weave the stories of the journey to find my father within those interviews of each family member. And so that's the framework. It's told in that way. The second book is called Nobody Wants to Talk About It, Race, Identity, and the Difficulties in Forging Meaningful Conversations. And that book is about my journey traveling around the country for the past 15 years, trying to get people to talk about race and all of the crazy situations that I've found myself in where people have been reluctant or embarrassed or whatever it might have been. And I discovered a set of tools, seven tools that can help people have more authentic, more meaningful conversations about race and identity.
Absolutely. So as a person that mentioned George Floyd, as a person who's gone through different iterations of understanding race, politics, institutions, structures that work in different ways for different people. What's your take on it today? Like, what, as a person that this has been a part of your life's work, right? Where do you see these perceptions and understandings around race, identity, ethnicity, culture, gender, sexuality, right? How do you see these things evolving as someone who's literally lived through the evolution and has written works and produced works around this information and your lived experience of this information? How do you see it today?
Yeah, the main focus of my work is something that really became apparent to me a number of years ago, something I discovered, I sort of stumbled upon, and it's an academic theory called intergroup contact theory. Intergroup contact theory is the proven theory that by sharing our personal stories across majority and minority populations, we can break down the prejudices that exist between us by discovering that we have more in common than we have different. That's a fact. We have more in common than we have different. And yet we allowed the differences to separate us and to keep us from finding the commonalities. And so the main focus of my work is based upon that principle, I think.
Okay. And the principle is, so in accepting the fact that we're more alike than we are different, right? I think most logical people will agree with that. Is the part of that theory that is the work, the in fact, the reluctance and or acceptance of sharing and believing people's lived in stories, like, right? Because we are made better when we share stories amongst minority and majority groups, but there's also inherent in that the need for the groups to speak and be heard and acknowledge, and then also to listen, understand and acknowledge, right? On both sides, right? So is that really what this is about? It's about storytelling in order to create space for that to occur? Because that to me would be the challenge in that theory, is that you need participating and willing sides on both parts of the spectrum in order to contribute for this to actually move forward.
Sure. Absolutely. The theory is posited by a guy named Gordon G. Allport, who was a psychiatrist at Harvard, wrote a book back in the 50s called The Nature of Prejudice.
Yep.
And it's a very thorough and detailed work about bringing people together and doing this work in terms of finding commonalities. And one of the things that, again, as I mentioned, I discovered along the way was 7 tools that can help us have the conversations. The first tool is tell your story. It seems pretty obvious. We've been talking about it here. And tell your story. And it's in our stories that we find our commonalities. The second tool is don't judge the differences. Flip the script. Instead of allowing a difference to create a wall between us, start by finding a mutual interest and then embrace the differences. Because after all, if we were all the same, we'd be bored. It's the differences that make us stand out as people, and it's the differences that make us unique in the marketplace.
Number three. To that third point, but are there differences that you believe, in just hearing this, right? Are there differences that you believe that people are more likely to embrace because it doesn't challenge their status quo versus differences, right? Like if I'm impoverished and I'm impoverished because I live in this neighborhood and redlining happened here, and I tell you that's my difference, right? You also need to remove your own feelings around reasoning, why, whatever, and then just hear my reason for us being different. Does that make sense?
Yes. I guess I would say I am talking on a broader level and less so using the detail of I live in a neighborhood that's redlined and that's my difference from you. There are obviously probably much more clearer differences that people would recognize. And so as you get into it, you can start to share more of those things. And again, we're all different. That's what makes us unique. And so not everybody is going to embrace all of the differences, but that is the goal.
Sure. No, I'm discussing redlining as meaning like that may change my access to education. Sure. It may change the type of job I have. It may change my median income.
I understand all that.
Right. And for the audience. Right. So when we're like, well, what's different? Right. We're both human beings. I look different. I'm from New York. You're from Chicago. Great. We can talk about that or from California. And then, right, we could talk about those things, right? But then there are some other differences that are a bit more deeper and individualized to my experience of what different looks like and your experience of what different looks like. And so I'm just asking how much in your understanding of it does it account for those differences, right? Where it's like, our differences may just be surface, skin tone, darker, lighter, whatever. And then there's sort of like economic differences, access to resource differences, right? And so are those a part of the conversation, or is it more so really just talking about humanity and our differences in human experience?
Absolutely. But most people probably aren't going to start there. They're going to start with the cosmetic things that you mentioned, like the things that we can see or hear or things that are on the top of our minds or whatever. As you get deeper, it's going to be harder and harder to come to reconcile those things. But all of those things are on the table. All of those things define who we are.
So like an accent would be one of those things. Like, oh, you sound, absolutely. Where are you from? You sound like you're from somewhere. Someone's like, I'm from here.
A different language.
Oh, I'm from here. Right. That's the difference that we both have.
Right.
Got it. Okay. So that's the third pillar.
That is the second tool. The third tool is that we have to recognize that there isn't just one way to have a conversation about race.
Got it.
If there was one way to do it, we'd all be doing it. It'd make it a lot easier.
Yep.
But we all come to the table with a different set of experiences, with a different lens. And so therefore, it's going to be messy. The way that we just had this conversation today is going to be different for your next guest and for another guest and for another person. Everybody comes to the table with a different lens, with a different experience. And therefore, that conversation is going to be different. It's going to be messy. We need to recognize that. And that's actually part of the thing that is the strength of our collective diversity, is that we have all these different experiences. The fourth thing is we can disagree so long as we're not disagreeable. And right now in this country, there's a lot of disagreeableness going on. If we could agree to disagree, we'd be in better shape.
Now, I'm going to question. So some of them I don't have questions on, others I will, just because I'm that sort of person. And this would be a boring podcast if I just let someone talk and did nothing, at least for me. So when we're talking about, right, because this is premised on conversations around race, right? So yeah.
Race and identity, yes.
Race and identity, right? So we can disagree, but is our disagreement, do we have to first acknowledge objective truths and then disagree on subjective ideas, or do I have the right to disagree even if there's data that shows me that this, that what you're showing me is in fact true and right?
Look,
I don't know. I'm just asking. I think that's the first thing off my head. Like,
don't use the Tucker Carlson line on me now. I'm just asking questions.
Yeah,
I mean that's a perfect example though, and let's use that. There is a lot of disagreement today about what facts are and what truth is.
Absolutely.
But that doesn't mean that we still can't have a civil conversation.
Got it.
So I may not like Trump or Tucker Carlson. I'm laying it all out, but it doesn't really matter. I mean, but if I want to, let's say a Trump supporter, if I want to have a conversation with someone who I don't agree with, and perhaps they have different statistics and data than I have, if I get all worked up and get disagreeable with them, how much longer do you think we're going to have a conversation? Not very long. It's probably going to stop pretty quickly. And so there are some places where you're just like, the objective is to not necessarily change someone's mind, although we would all like to think that we could change somebody's mind, but to have a conversation in which we're not going to get angry with one another and spew things at one another that would cause hurt. Does that?
Like comparing my question to Tucker Carlson, which kind of hurt me, by the way.
I wasn't comparing your question. I was comparing.
Yeah, I'm just asking a question. You're like,
I'm just asking questions.
I saw that. I heard that. So we're really talking about civility, right? So this is less about disagreement around information. This is about the civility in the disagreement.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Number five is get comfortable being uncomfortable. I don't know that I need to say any more about that. I could talk about that for a while, but we don't need to. Number six is that we have to understand that there are realities outside of our own experience. Just because we may not have experienced racism or sexism or homophobia or age discrimination or disability indifference or some other form of discriminatory treatment doesn't mean that those are not realities for other people.
Okay.
And a lot of times people don't take that into consideration. They just deny someone's existence, deny someone's experience. And
or I believe that people exist in a space where the denial of one's existence or the magnitude of one's neglect to acknowledge others' lived experiences. Yeah. If you're in the median, if you're in the middle, right, then you actually can harbor anti whatever that thing is ideas, but not act because you're not actually so far in the section of being problematic and hateful that you're almost like, oh, that can't be me, right? And so there's a ton of people where you're like, that was a microaggression. They're like, no, that wasn't. I never harbor any sort of racist ideas. I would never do anything like that, right? And it's like, no, you don't have to. It's not calling me the N-word isn't the only version of this that exists, right? There's a version of this, right, where, you know, you say, oh, you look like some random other black person, right? And I'm just like, no. Or do you tan, right? You get these things, right? But it's not race, it's not intended maybe to hurt. And so you then end up in dialogue where it's like, well, that's hurtful. And it's like, but it shouldn't be hurtful. It can't be hurtful because that's not where it came from. And in that way, I think that there's also this really interesting median space of people that are well-intending, but ultimately have these sort of ideas in their heads. And you have to be able to have really intelligent, really empathic, or decide to, because you actually don't, no one's responsible for anyone else's thoughts, but you can decide to have really empathic, really intelligent conversations around it so that, you know, they're only, so that the only examples aren't these kind of polar examples of what exclusionary idea looks like.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. We have to be able to see outside our lens. You know, people talk about unconscious biases and you're like, well, I'm unconscious of it. How would I even know I have, you know what I mean? And so it's like, yeah, how do you get conscious of your unconscious bias? Well, there are a lot of different ways that you can jar yourself into, you know, finding out what those are. But that's, we need to look outside of our lens. Yeah. And see what's out there and acknowledge that it's real.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
The last tool is something we talked about earlier, and that's practice forgiveness. Again, as I said, it's the most difficult work you will ever do, but also the most rewarding. So,
cool. Michael, all right. So I had two questions that I asked everyone that has done the Man vs. Brand podcast.
Yes.
Which would be kind of interesting because I feel like you might have your Imitation of Life, I saw all three, sort of now makes me know that you're probably gonna have a good take on this. So on any streaming platform, theater, TV, movies, what's something that you have recently watched that you thoroughly enjoyed?
Recently watched, not read or anything like that. Yeah,
read,
watch.
I'll take read. That's cool. We're looking for recommendations.
Oh, so, sure. I know. Yeah. I mean, I read a lot, so I mean, I could name off several books. The Sum of Us by Heather McGee, which I just finished not too long ago, is an incredible book. Cast by Isabel Wilkerson is an amazing book. Just read that. How the Word is Passed by Clint Smith is dynamite book, beautiful, beautifully written. Things that I've seen, I do watch a lot of Imitation of Life, a lot of shows, things like that. My wife is like, can you watch something else? Nope. I did just recently rewatch Ken Burns's 10-part documentary on jazz, because I'm a huge jazz vinyl collector.
Okay.
I love jazz on vinyl, and I rewatched that series and it is incredible because it's not, it doesn't just tell the story about the roots of jazz and how it was birthed and how it came about, but it also talks about the history of racism in America, because obviously blacks were much more prominent and responsible for the creation of jazz, and that was all going on in a country that was deeply racist. And so how did that all take place? So he talks about the history of racism in our country quite a bit in the show. And it was just a really, in addition to just hearing some unbelievably great music, it was just such a beautiful portrait of resilience.
So Ken Burns,
yeah,
documentary on jazz, is it currently playing on streaming networks?
Yeah, you can go to the PBS app.
Okay.
And you can catch it there at the PBS app. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, second question.
Yeah.
So what's something that you watch, read, enjoy that maybe folks in your life, aside from maybe your wife, may not necessarily know that you really, really love this movie, this show, this concept, but you actually do?
Well, that's a really good question. Totally unprepared for that. I guess I would say, what would it be? That I secretly love, but people don't know. That's what you're asking?
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily have to be a guilty pleasure. I've heard, like, I'm into field hockey, and a lot of people in my life don't know that I watch, like, European field hockey consistently. I go to bars that play European field hockey, or something like, you know, I'm a pastor, but I love Marvel, and I see no conflict in mutants and my Christian belief system, right? Like, there's these kind of spaces where it's like, I get to have this thing, and this thing is kind of like a thing that maybe I don't really talk about, but I thoroughly enjoy it. So there's a wide spectrum.
I would say, unless you came over to my house, you wouldn't know this about me, but I collect everything. Everything. I collect art. I collect black art, Negro memorabilia. I collect color by number paintings. I collect historical documents. Up on my wall here, I have the document of the induction of my great-great-grandfather into the 54th Regiment of the Colored Infantry Unit in the Civil War, dated 1864. I have my great-grandfather's Negro Leagues players contract, dated July 13th, 1924. I have other historical documents and pictures and autographs. I'm kind of obsessed with historical things, but also things to me that are things of beauty.
So is this something where you're going to, like, private auctions, you're going to eBay, you found, like, kind of some niche websites that sort of provide them? Like, where are you finding this type of stuff?
Well, obviously the family documents are from family, but other historical things I've gotten in all kinds of places in all kinds of ways. You know, if you don't want to pay top dollar for them, you've got to sort of search and dig under the piles and find those things. Whether it's a great jazz record, or whether it's a beautiful painting, or an object of art, of black art or something, you just got to really dig under and find them. And so I'm a digger. I'm a searcher.
All right. So am I, man. I have a first edition Langston Hughes composition of his work. I have James Baldwin on record doing an interview. A lot of
stuff that I would go for, brother.
I'm a huge collector of art, of as you can probably see my background, maybe a little bit, but also of like very specific things from very specific time periods.
Yes.
And works that are specific to a time period, right? So like maybe I don't even know what I have. Like I have like 1930s advertisement around soap that was meant for black people, right? Like, so just that type of sort of interesting history that is art, but that is also like sort of thoughtful and that creates conversation and creates research, I think is really cool, man. So see, we're in our seven principles. We're seven principling it out right now. It's awesome.
Well, you're in New York, right?
I'm in New York. Yeah.
There's a great place in Brooklyn called Black Market where you can pick up all kinds of very, very interesting and historical things related to the black community. I suggest. All right,
I'll check it out. I live in Harlem, so I get to experience a lot of that. If it's Schomburg or the Studio Museum, there's a lot of history here, Ailey. I'll check it out. Black Market, man. Anyone listening, don't go until first week of October, by the way. Stay away. All right. So if someone, Mike, wants to find more about Incognito, find more out about your second book, find more out about what you're doing, if there's workshops you're teaching, if there's a way that maybe their department or their company can get you to come in and do maybe some diversity inclusion work, if you're still in that space, where should they go so that they can connect with you in order to get more of your content?
Incognito the Play, all one word, incognitotheplay.com. You can find everything you need there. There's books you can find there. There's video there. You can listen to the pod. I have a podcast called Incognito the Podcast. You can listen to that there. And you can find me on Instagram at Incognito the Play.
All right, cool. So right now, guys, why don't you head over to Incognito the Podcast? Is that what it's called?
Incognito the Play. That's the website. And
the podcast.
Incognito the Podcast is the podcast. That's right.
So Incognito Podcast. Right now, stop. You're probably listening to this on a podcast. If you are, Incognito the Podcast right now. Yeah. So pause it, search for it, find it if you're listening to it. If you're watching, of course, you can find the podcast on any podcasting platform. You can also go to the website. You can pause this video in YouTube or any of the other various spaces where you might be engaging in this content and go find out what Michael Fosberg is doing. Mike, thank you so much for participating, for joining us in conversation around this topic. I really appreciate your insight and applaud the work that you've done. And I think that, as we progress as a society, the more that we understand diverse and varying experiences, the better we all become. There was someone, and I'm going to bastardize their quote, but, if the worst of us is not doing well, then we're all not doing well, right? So in a culture, right, if the lowest of your population, if they are not thriving, then your culture is not in fact thriving. And there's been different people that have created variations on that, speaking to specific people and specific, genders and races and all that, but I believe it's true. And so your work really speaks to uniting rather than bringing us apart, and that is commendable. I appreciate your time. Guys, thank you for listening to the podcast. I appreciate you guys always. Make sure you like, subscribe, buy the merch. The merch is cool. And I'll see you next time on Man vs. Brand. Thank you. Bye.